Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Lyle Goldstein. I'm a professor at Naval War College, and I'm very pleased to be here at the Davis Center. At Naval War College, I work on, largely I study the Chinese Navy and also the Russian Navy, but I managed to dabble in other things too, including U.S.-Russia relations, U.S.-China relations, and of course, now today, Russia-China relations. Let me have my colleague introduce himself.
Hello, everyone. My name is Vitaly Kozarev. I'm professor of international studies and political science at Endicott College, Beverly, Massachusetts. And I've been working on the relationship between the three great powers, United States, China, and Russia, for about 20 years. And my background is the economic history of China. So I'm very excited to have this opportunity to present for the audiences at the Davis Center. Thank you.
Great, so let me, I'll share our slides here. And we'll get started. I think we'll talk for about, about 40 minutes, share with you some of our research, and then look for an interesting dialogue. As it turns out, Professor Kozarev and I presented at the Davis Center a couple of years ago on a similar topic. So we're back to share, as it were, an update of our research. We've now put this together in a book project. And so in that respect, we're excited to get some feedback and listen to your comments and questions so we can improve this book we're putting together. We hope to finish up about next year. So let me, let's move ahead and get started. I think Professor Kozarev and I are well positioned to deeply probe this important relationship, in part because we're both monitoring Russian and Chinese media extremely closely. As you can see, you can get an idea of that from these slides. It's very apparent that both countries are talking about this critical relationship. You can even see here they're sort of in a way leaning on each other. That's evident. Now you'll see two different strands here, a close look at what's going on the security side in the military domain, but also in the economic and cultural domain as well. So today we'll focus mainly in the security realm. The book will probably be more balanced, however, so I think it will appeal to readers with a broad range of interest. Let's get right to the point of our research project. Here you see our research question. We're really trying to characterize this absolutely critical relationship. And our working hypothesis, having sifted a lot of the data, is what this relationship is amounts to we call it a quasi-alliance. We didn't invent this term, but we think it is a really accurate one. And on this wide spectrum of how bilateral relations can go, and indeed, this relationship has witnessed periods of hot rivalry, of cold rivalry, of wary partnership, and indeed full alliance. But today we see it as a quasi-alliance. And we base our conclusions the evidence that's piling up. We are using principally case studies. But I think the biggest contribution of our work will be its very careful look at what is going on out there in a variety of different areas. So the book will have an entire chapter, say, on the Korean Peninsula. So let me let's now look briefly at the existing literature, which is growing very quickly. If we were to kind of try to categorize the different viewpoints, it fits rather easily into our three basic schools in international relations. As you saw, I took the title of this talk partly from a phrase made famous by Bobo Lo, who put a statement out there recently. And the his conclusion that this is a kind of a brittle relationship that is not very strong contrasts very much so with Lukin's contribution. I have the date wrong. Lukin's book was published in 2018, a very fine book. But we see Lo and Lukin disagree very starkly. I would characterize Lukin as a realist, yes, although his views are very complex, but partly because even in the third sentence of his book, he says that that really what's driving this is the West's quest for primacy, for a kind of the hegemony of the West, the unipolar world. And indeed, Mearsheimer, kind of one of the greatest American realist thinkers, also thinks it's a brittle relationship. So he agrees with Beaubuleau, I think. Now, the dominant school in American thinking on this, however, is not really the realist school. I would say it's the liberals. Liberal thinking, of course, quite dominant, say, in the American press, holds that we should look first and foremost at regime type, and that we can understand this relationship as these two authoritarian powers coming together, hence, again, in the title of our talk, the axis of authoritarians. And there's certainly something to this, although we don't want to, in our view, we don't want to overstate this. And I would guess Professor Kozarev and I probably sympathize, excuse me, most with the constructivist viewpoint. And here there's a series of very fine books, Kaczmarski, for example, or Rosman. These books are trying to explain what they view as a as really a puzzle in some ways. How is it that this relationship turns out to be actually rather strong? It's not brittle, as Lo said, but it's not just a marriage of convenience, but it's something rather strong, and we need to understand that. And they would argue that it's really identity that holds this relationship together in a strong way. And I also highlight the recent work by Shevchenko and Larson. We like that book very much, and we start see our view as kind of building on their work, actually, in thinking that more or less Russia and China are joined together by their quest for status. So let me turn it now over to Professor Kozarev, who will discuss how the relationship came together and then share some case studies.
Thank you so much. This is the timeline reflecting the evolution of this partnership. And as we can see in the 90s and early 2000s, it was mostly as a result of the attempt by China and Russia to balance the unipolar world until the two parties signed the Treaty of Good Neighborliness. And this was the milestone for the development of a new kind of self-sustained type of partnership, strategic partnership between China and Russia in the 21st century. I would say that probably the 2012, the rise of Xi Jinping in China and the new term of President Putin marked a very important milestone, a very important development in terms of mutual recognition of the joint interests, not only regionally, but globally. And we have the Ukraine crisis as the turning point when Russia has been gravitating since then toward China. And I would probably say that throughout the period of 2014 until today, the two declarations might be mentioned, the 2016 and 2019 joint declarations with the claim of China and Russia as the global balancers and the important role of contribution in terms of the order forming process. Next slide, please. The new reality after the Trump administration's started its term since 2017, the new reality is the so-called post-neoliberal world, the new conditions when China and Russia have been very much focusing into originally into balancing by means of hedging, bandwagoning against the United States hegemony and the hegemony of the West to a more systemic confrontation with the West, especially given the new perception of national security in the United States. We all know the national security strategy of 2017 with emphasis on great power rivalry. We have seen the evolution of China's holistic approach to the international relations, more inclusive, whereas Russia, since probably the Yukos affair, started feeling itself as an encircled fortress, encircled by the hostile powers and forces, and started fighting for the so-called privileged interests. After 2008, the declining West thesis played an important role, especially given the fact that now it is China and Russia which could see itself as good global citizens, trying to not only to tackle the decline of the West, but also to alternate somehow the West and establish some sort of non-Western part of the world within the existing construction. The key question is now is to what extent, for example, the new emphasis in the United States and the West on ideologization of the East-West confrontation might influence the authoritarian features and the evolution of authoritarian features in both countries, and to what extent authoritarianism might really be a factor of a deeper partnership. And finally is to what extent this new post-neoliberal reality stimulate a deepened partnership and leaving some room for improvement. So our case studies probably demonstrate some of the important changes. So the first case would be the Central Asia, the core of Eurasia, which is probably one of the major focuses in the joint Sino-Russian agenda, especially in terms of establishing since the formation of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization in 2001, establishing some sort of condominium in this region, in this important part of the world and part of Eurasia as well. And also to fend off the increasing interference by the extra-regional forces and new Western initiatives, including the NATO. The key probably strategy the two parties have developed the establishment of the Greater Eurasian Partnership. I'll probably elaborate on this a little bit more. And also the ability of Russia and China to kind of coordinate the agenda. And everybody agrees that probably Russia is having to accommodate to China's rising economic role in the region. And we see here some Russia-China Central Asia trade statistics. 2015, it was about 20 billion with Russia Central Asia. Today, 2019, it was already 28 billion. Whereas China at 2015, it was 32 billion. Whereas 2019, it exceeded 42 billion. So we see the big difference in terms of economic dependency. Next slide, please. But nevertheless, what we see, we can say, and we can refer to Sergei Karaganov, the prominent expert in Russia, who who said that actually both countries have agreed not to compete with each other in Central Asia. So, and the major drivers remain today is as to secure stabilization of the region, to prevent radicalization in the context of the fighting against the three evils and so-called Afghanistanization of the Central Asian region, to secure a smooth leadership transition and friendly attitudes among the elites in these countries, keep regional economies within the respective integration models, meaning the Belt and Road Initiative and Russia's Eurasian Economic Union, and also to somehow find the ways to address the second coming of the United States to the region. Next slide. So what we see is that, especially since the late 2019 and early 2020, kind of a new development of the new Eurasia strategy in the United States, and the two countries have to find some ways to develop a counter strategy. The Eurasia strategy is not only Central Asia, it's also some new policies in Europe and new policies toward the Asia-Pacific region, but we're not covering this today. So we will remember Mike Pompeo's efforts to really improve relationship with the leadership of the Central Asia, revitalize the C5+1 format, especially engaging the elites of these countries. There is a debate in the United States to what extent Afghanistan should be linked to the Central Asian developments and US policy in Central Asia, but overall, the effort to stimulate regionalization of Central Asia without the interference of great powers nearby is a big, very important point in this new strategy, and especially to prevent irreversible docking of Central Asian economies into Russia's and China's integration initiatives. There are some doubts about what extent this kind of double teaming, or we call this division of labor, might sustain. And there is one of the quotes that there might be some sort of in shaping the security agenda and economic agenda in the region, the two countries might have some frictions, yes. But on the other hand, they have larger goals, which might really drive and maintain them in a, on a friendly basis.
Right. Now, let me, speaking of division of labor, let me move into our second case study, which concerns the Korean Peninsula. And we may recall that the war occurred 70 years ago, by the way. You may recall that Russia and China collaborated closely in that war. And here I am showing from a Chinese military journal how, in fact, the this is quite extraordinary, their depiction here of the Soviet pilots. By the recall that that was a secret at the time. So it's quite unusual for the Chinese to highlight the achievements of the Russian pilots. And you know, if this was 20 or 30 years ago, you never would have seen this kind of discussion. But what I'm saying is that this is a kind of new historiography. Not only if you read Chinese media, you know that right now they're really playing up the history of the Korean War, but it turns out playing up the Russian role and indeed Russia-China collaboration. And I can show you more evidence of that, but that plays into this story here. But let's, you know, Korea has really been on everybody's mind over the last couple of years because of the nuclear crisis, of course. And here, it seems that Russia and China are continually coalescing toward a common position and putting forward common proposals. And I don't think it's at all coincidental that really the main, as it were, I think we can term it an arms control framework that is at work on the peninsula today is indeed looks a lot like the double freeze proposal that China and Russia put forward. I don't want to exaggerate that. That is double freeze, you know, is kind of under assault, as it were, including by the Kim regime, which recently just showed off that huge new ICBM. But what I'm saying is more or less the note that it hasn't been tested, and more or less this kind of truce holds. But I think it is essential to say that where did this idea originate from? And it was put forward by Russia and China. So I think that's important to recognize. I would also highlight that here when I look at what Russian and Chinese specialists are saying, here's, for instance, Georgi Tolaraya, who has spent more time in Pyongyang than anybody I know. But he says, if you look closely at an interview that he did with Rossiyskaya Gazeta, that he says very clearly, you know, he says we should look to a Chinese proposal, actually. He says that that's interesting. And then in a kind of reciprocal action, when I look at Chinese specialists, and these two Chinese specialists, we should take quite seriously, partly because they studied at Kim Il-sung University in Pyongyang, so they are the experts. And they're saying, actually, it turns out that Russia-China cooperation could be one of the keys. So what I'm saying is they're coming together, they're looking to each other to cooperate toward regional solutions to this ongoing crisis. And there's more to it than that, actually. For example, in fall 2019, a year ago, the Russia and China put on a very unusual exercise, a strategic aviation joint exercise that flew off the Japan Sea, very proximate to Korea. The Korean Air Force came up and there was actually shooting involved, I think warning shots. Nevertheless, you know, this is a very serious incident, but it shows the continual coalescing of Russian and Chinese viewpoints on Northeast Asia and even that desire for joint action. That's also reflected in this, again, a very unusual headline here you see from Izvestia, where they're, you know, this is the Russian general staff saying that American BMD is a threat to both Russia and China. I mean, having that in the headline, you know, almost suggests a kind of common mentality of security. And I think we're seeing that more and more. Now, let me switch gears to our third case study, which is the Arctic. And here I think is a very interesting assessment I pulled from a Chinese naval journal, and where they not only assert, if you look in the top left, that the Arctic is absolutely critical for Chinese future development, but in the top right, the statement, pretty extraordinary statement to say that Russia is the key link for China into the Arctic, okay? Now, this was written in 2016, But you got to realize that in 2018, China published this white paper where they said, you know, where they basically put out there this polar silk road. Again, quite extraordinary and something that Russia has more or less embraced. So this is a set of major developments for Russia-China cooperation. And, you know, talk is cheap, of course, but here you see some of the really, I would say, quite impressive actions that are going on. Just look at this, by the way. This is from a month ago, the satellite photo that shows how much open water there is in the Arctic. Quite depressing for those of us worried about climate change. But if you're an enthusiast of the Northern Sea Route, then this is very interesting indeed. But what I want to say, not only is Russia invested a huge amount in revamping its icebreaker fleet with many more on the way. And by the way, that money could have been spent on the Russian Navy. It wasn't. It was put into the Northern Sea Route. But this is a win-win for China. Not only is China massively invested in the Yamal gas fields up here that are carrying this oil and gas, but the Boris Sokolov, for example, is an excellent example of a, you know, China-Russia win-win, Shuangying. That is the ship, quite an extraordinary ship built to travel the Northern Sea Route during the winter, folks. Think about that, the Northern Sea Route in the winter, an extraordinary feat, requiring some very high-tech shipbuilding indeed. But this ship built in Guangzhou, so, you know, the Chinese shipyard is happy and the Russian customer is happy because it is sailing along the Northern Sea Route year round, something that's quite amazing. And to go in a slightly different direction here on the Arctic, you know, there are security issues to worry about. I wouldn't want to exaggerate this, but, you know, I think it's important to suggest that, here's a Russian strategist discussing Chinese submarine basing in Arctic ports, and that would constitute a major threat to the United States. So we have to be aware of this. I don't think, you know, China is endorsing this. I don't think Russia, this is not some kind of official statement from the Kremlin or anything, but the fact that Russian strategists are musing on these issues and where, you know, what can Russia do for China in the Arctic in a security sense, that is very troubling indeed, and shows us where this sort of quasi-alliance could become much more problematic for us if it were to reach more the stages of an actual alliance. Okay, let me turn it back to Vitaly here.
Okay, flying back to the Middle East. As I said, the Middle East is an example of what I call the chaotic multipolarity, which is has been since the global war on terror. I mean, the Middle East has become the region where there is a big necessity to stabilize the Middle East, and also to, especially after the Arab Spring 2011 and the Libyan Gaddafi regime failure, we have a very big important discourse of the how to protect principles of the international law and sovereignty and non-interference. I wrote something on the China's Russia's evolution on responsibility to protect principle. Also, in the Middle East, the two countries have been trying to demonstrate some sort of alternative to a failing U.S. strategy in the region, especially given the fact that the United States has decided to withdraw partly from the region. And in this case, in this chaotic multipolarity, there is a big actually demand to establish some geometric figures with the key regional players, Iran, Turkey, Saudi Arabia, Israel, and secure economic interests. Of course, there are different economic positioning in this region for both Moscow and Beijing. Moscow's very delicate relationship with Turkey and Saudi Arabia, not less complex relationship between the China and Turkey at this point. And also the Saudi Arabia is one of the biggest important partner of China. Also, there is a big discussion about the post-civil war or post-war settlement in Syria and Russia's engaged into conversations what Russia really can do in terms of economic development and economic reconstruction in Syria. Libya and Egypt, especially given the new role of Turkey, I'll elaborate on this in a sec, have become a real hotspots in this big chaotic multipolarity game in the region. And also the Tehran and Iran gravitating toward China really, really significantly. And maybe next slide will show us. So next slide shows that it is not only in the economic sphere, but also in the sphere of arms control and arms sales to Iran, especially given the fact that October 18th, the UN sanctions were lifted and the United States now is trying to actually apply some sort of unilateral sanctions on sales, arms sales to Iran. But nevertheless, China and Russia and Iran in December 2019 conducted a first joint naval drill in the Gulf of Oman. And that was a big sign. And they said it's not the last drill, last maneuvers. And when the more sanctions are promised and also more economic pressure is being conducted by the United States, the Iranian foreign minister is flying in September to China to actually get some help from China. So what we see is that probably we might be looking into the closer kind of condominium relationship between Russia, China, and Iran in the end, and maybe given especially the changing role of Turkey. And this Turkey's new role we associate with the so-called development of new Ottomanism in Turkey's policies, which is a big, is considered to be a big shift, including in Russia and China. And China tried to engage Turkey as early as 2015 into its Belt and Road Initiative. But eventually, Turkey decided not to rely on this and decided to really stick to the more like pro-Western, pro-American course at that time. And especially given the recent, probably since 2017, the drift from pan-Turkism toward new Ottomanism, which is based on certain principles, like the, especially the role of Islam and the role of the more centralized presidential power. And that is something that China and Russia believe that it might create some danger. And they, especially in terms of Turkey's active support of the Uyghur population, we see now the situation in Nagorno-Karabakh, where Turkey is openly taking sides and very supportive of Azerbaijan, and very ambitiously challenging Russia's role in over there, but at the same time being supportive of the Uyghurs, including in Central Asia. It's challenging China's very sensitive attitudes toward this issue. Also, we have Turkey and China competing for the markets because they produce many items, many goods similar, and they're competing in different markets. And also they compete for the energy flows from Central Asia, including Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, and Kazakhstan. Especially Turkey is dreaming about enhanced role of as a transit country to supply to Europe. As a response to these spoilers, and the Russians and Chinese are looking for some new overarching constructions, and especially the Greater Eurasian Partnership, which Putin proposed in the end of 2015. And now we have the evolution of this, and even some principles of the Greater Eurasian Partnership have been announced. And this is this seems to be an inclusive, not against the West partnership. It is not rejecting political pluralism, and which is not imposing any specific political model on the participants. It's a flexible structure of this partnership with multi-speed accession of those who are willing to join. Social-cultural interactions are important, not only between the elites of those countries, members of this partnership. Embrace different security instruments. So this is an attempt using this Great Eurasian Partnership, not only for economic purposes, but also to address certain security threats. And for example, some experts believe that it's not a Eurasian isolationism, so they are welcome to still maintain a liberal economic order in the world global-wise. And also it needs to be based on certain bottom-up process with independent the formation of independent financial and monetary instruments, and especially given the fact that Russia and China and some other partners already started signing agreements on the currency swaps and trying to de-dollarize their economic relationship. Next, please.
Okay, Let me, as our last case study that we'll present today, let's talk about the military security domain. Obviously, this is of great interest. And here, I can say we Professor Kozarev and I just published a piece in the Journal of Peace and War Studies, a survey of our conclusions here on this. So get in touch with us and we'll send that to you. But there's a lot to talk about here. I'll just give you a quick summary, but we have to start with these red arrows where we see that in really almost every domain of warfare that really China has experienced a incredible great leap forward thanks to its close collaboration with Russia, importing, for example, S-400 air defense missiles. The Su-27, the basic flanker platform, has completely revamped Chinese air power and launched it ahead. And then here you see, for example, and this is really just showing you the tip of the iceberg here, these destroyers here have created a very strong foundation so that, you know, having evaluated, for example, China's latest generation cruiser recently, that cruiser takes all the best, you know, lessons and equipment from these older ships, and again has transformed the Chinese Navy into something, into really a very cutting edge force. A few more things to say here. It's not just the equipment, folks, it's also the culture. And here I would just share from you a page from Guofangbao, which I read regularly. And in Guofangbao, it's not a long newspaper, but they always have a page about international affairs. And here you see, this is just a very typical rendering here where three of the four articles on their international page are about Russia in some way, whether it's Russian command and control or the special forces doctrine or what Russia is doing to stand up to NATO. Here's a piece on Japan, a small little piece in the corner. But what I'm saying is that Russian ideas about military affairs definitely pervade the Chinese military media. And it's, you know, let's not forget that hundreds of China's best military officers are going off to Russian academies every year. Here's another example of this, where the title of this article, you know, Geng Yuan, Geng Nan, Geng Shi, meaning, you know, more further, more difficult, and greater realism in these exercises. This is an article written by a professor at Naval Engineering University, so he knows of what he speaks, and he's not just talking about counterterrorism and peacekeeping, folks. This is also about, you know, how to hunt carriers and prosecute submarines and things like that. So these exercises are, they could be bigger and more serious, but there's something to be concerned about here. The big news, though, in the military side of this relationship was President Putin's announcement a year ago at Valdai that that they would work closely together in strategic early warning against ballistic missile attacks. Clearly, that's a very big step. It's an extremely sensitive area. And when I looked at an assessment from mid-2020 that was undertaken by Fudan University and the Russian Academy of Sciences, you know, their conclusion was this is the kind of cooperation undertaken by, you see these two characters, Mengguo. Okay, Mengguo-Jijian, right, between allies. So that's a, you know, that's a powerful statement of where this relationship is at, certainly on the military security side. One more thing, and this is really what keeps me up at night, folks, is, as you can imagine, I spend a lot of time looking at the future of naval warfare. And here we see that, you know, China, Russian technology and doctrine has powerfully informed where China is going. Not only with getting a hold of, you know, Soviet submarine design from a very early point, but when you look at the details, for example, I've studied Chinese UUV development found in the 1990s when China went out to test this prototype of a UUV, really its first big achievement in that realm, half the ship was crewed by Russian scientists as well, okay? Looking further, mine warfare, and this is a particular danger, I think, to the U.S. Navy these days. You know, this is not a shallow look at Russian mine warfare. This is a very systematic study of what China could learn and how it could threaten, you know, adversary platforms, including, for example, submarines. Speaking of submarines, here's the latest news, folks. In August 2020, Russia and China announced that they are officially working on a conventional submarine, the next generation diesel submarine together. Okay, and that's a very major development for both navies. So something we need to keep an eye on very much so. I do want to insert a caveat here, though. We see a lot of coalescing and where China and Russia are lashing up, but there are some problems in the relationship. We're not minimizing those, and our book will go fully into some of the tensions. Here you see, for example, here's a Russian defense specialist who is convinced that China is a grave threat to Russia. He wrote a whole book on that, and he's frequently writing in the Russian press. So that viewpoint exists. We think that it's quite, that is not, the majority viewpoint, that that's kind of an isolated group of specialists, but there are those Russians who are very concerned about China. Another thing, there are issues that divide them. India might be one of them. Here you see some speculation on that in the South China Morning Post. But again, in our view, those issues, they exist, but we don't see that as the dominant trend. And I did want to also make a comment on, as we know that right at this moment, perhaps Russian and American negotiators are talking a lot about strategic nuclear arms control. I think we all hope that they would come to some kind of agreement sooner rather than later. But we know that this has been involving China more and more. And here you see some evidence from that Fudan Russian Academy of Sciences study I looked at, where it says that the Russian specialists indeed would like to see China included. So you can see that in private, the Russians are kind of hoping to pull the Chinese along, and that's probably a good thing. But I think our main conclusion here, thinking about the structure of future arms control arrangements, is that Russia is not willing to kind of, as it were, follow Washington's lead. They're not willing to put heavy overt pressure on the Chinese. They're more, willing to realize that China seems to want to go its own ways, may need more time, and so forth, is not ready to engage in those negotiations. And let me hand it back to Vitaly here to close the deal.
Just to add that that Putin actually elaborated on this issue on the arms control and the negotiations during his presentation and conversation at the Valdai Forum just probably 30 minutes ago in Moscow. He's been supportive of the Chinese position on this. Going back to the current pandemic situation, so that situation really stirred a lot of suspicions in Russia and elsewhere in the world. And lots of, I know that different experts were looking at China with rising suspicions. But the point is that despite all those effects of COVID-19 in terms of worsening or exacerbating the US-China frictions, Russia has decided to stick to the Chinese position, saying that it's not, don't blame China because this might happen everywhere. And also on the contrary, we need to use this opportunity to probably solidify our international community and address the common threat, including this global health issue, together, developing vaccine and collaborating and kind of making a new future with a more on a more collaborative basis. There is a question here about how actually COVID-19 might really change the security relationships between China and Russia. I think that there is they might be tilting toward multilateralization of different security issues, including the bioweapon and including those experiments, and especially given the recent backlash in Russia against America's presence in labs in the post-Soviet space, including Georgia, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, and also America's involvement in those experiments in China. It's been a big debatable issue in Russia and probably in China as well. And that is one of the issues which they actually pay attention to. And next slide. And the last thing here is that traditionally, since Russia and China position themselves at this point as the global balancers, especially concerned about the strategic stability, which reminds me the Soviet efforts in the late Soviet Union as the Soviet Union as the big pioneer and the big promoter of strategic stability. I think that one of the issues is that China and Russia have been very much like in on sync to like really destroy all efforts to create the so-called Asian NATO, or like creating the Quad type of relationship between India, Japan, Australia, and the United States within the framework of the new Indo-Pacific strategy. And all those efforts, especially with regard to India, we are ready to answer questions about China, Russia, India relationships, are part of this issue, not to allow, not to prevent the formation of a new Asian NATO. My question might appear, okay, we are having 20 years of the 2001 treaty, so what are we going to expect from a new treaty? And there's lots of speculations about this. Now we see that the countries, both Russia and China, have become more potent and more like visible in the international arena, especially given the Chinese leadership. They appraise each other. You see the quotes. They appraise each other's role in the international arena. So I would believe that probably they will try to enhance the the overarching efforts of to create a more efficient condominium in Eurasia, to stimulate and develop mechanisms to further economically integrate with each other. And we don't have the section on scientific integration, scientific exchange and collaboration, but there is a really substantial development in this area as well, let alone the military, which Lyle actually elaborated on. And probably some new roles in terms of order forming and agenda setting roles in the globally and in the region might really be in this important new treaty, which is supposed to be signed in 2021. And to conclude with, our study demonstrates that, yes, there is a need to study each region, many, many aspects of this very complex and overall pretty productive China-Russian collaboration in different parts of the world. That's why we based our studies based on concrete cases. We have the positive trajectory, especially since the Ukraine crisis, of the development of these relationships and a pretty consolidated position. US-China tensions actually stimulated proximity of Russia and China. And the American factor is, despite all efforts to say that, yes, Russia and China are having an independent development agenda. Yes, they have, but American factor is still very important. So cooperation and all those five cases show us that collaboration is very robust and very deep, but still remain a quasi-alliance. But there is a room to grow. We even could not rule out the possibility that the two countries might formalize this alliance, which is now seems to be unlikely, this prospect. But Vasily Kashin from Russia, expert on China, is saying there is only need, what is needed is political will, right? Another thing is that they, as Robert Kagan once said, that Moscow and Beijing represent different types of authoritarian regime. And they, on the one hand, they depend on each other in terms of legitimizing each other's regimes. And they kind of, they look at each other as an example. But on the other hand, the future of the evolution of this semi-alliance might depend on how they settle their domestic affairs and how actually the factor of China might be beneficial for the evolution of the Putin regime, and how vice versa, the Russian experiences might be a good example for China's CPC's legitimacy. Arms control needs to adapt to new balance of power. We see this chaotic multipolarity and new technologies, the mini nuclear bombs and other things that is, which we didn't mention, but these are the important drivers behind this. Pandemic strengthened overall their collaboration. An attempt to prevent the formation of the Asian NATO is also another driver. But on the other hand, the final thing here is that probably the West, including the United States, will have to overcome the new Cold War mentality indeed, and de-emphasize ideology and look at the pragmatic opportunities to enhance collaboration and probably find some beneficial points from multipolarity by increasing collaboration and cooperation with both Moscow and Beijing, and contribute to the formation of a new world order.
Okay, well, I'll put up our final slide here and we'll open it up now for the question and answer. And you can see Professor Kozarev and myself, our emails are right here. So please do reach out to us if you don't get your question discussed. But now we'll turn off the screen share and we can begin to, field some questions. Okay, I guess I'll, I see we have a very long list of questions here.
Yeah, probably first question, if you allow me, about the, to what extent Russia might really, is still willing to share Central Asia with China, especially given their Russia's status ambitions, or the goals vis-a-vis their relationship with China in Central Asia. I believe that despite all concerns and lots of publications about the increased role of China in Central Asia, I don't think that it is, as long as it meets the all important requirements and those principles of collaboration between China and Russia in Central Asia, including stability, economic prosperity, the smooth transition, which I mentioned. Actually, the Russians are not sitting and counting on, okay, who is doing what. So they have the many formats of on bilateral base and also within the multilateral framework. We remember the recent, media foreign ministers' councils meeting in St. Petersburg, and their statements covering both regional and global affairs, global issues. All right. If you go to to the SCO's website, there is a lot of activities by the SCO in monitoring the situation in these Central Asian states, including the election process and observers' missions, and including some other aspects. So I think that it's not something which is the zero-sum game type of relationship. So I think Russia has been accommodating. Russia is acknowledging Chinese leadership, especially in the economic sphere. So the problem is how to really get to a kind of sync and a consensus on certain principles and policies.
I might just quickly add that in terms of Central Asia, I do think, you know, it's important, especially if we're thinking from the American point of view, to think very hard about Afghanistan. I think I'm not in the minority in saying that I think many Americans would like to see that war come to a close and bringing American troops home. It behooves us to think hard about how Russia and China, how they might play a role in the future of Afghanistan. There, it seems to me that it's clear to me that neither Beijing nor Moscow benefits from any kind of radicalism or terrorism emanating from Afghanistan. So it seems to me this is, despite the headlines over the last year, I'm convinced that our country needs to work together with China and Russia to kind of help bring peace to the country. It's going to be extremely difficult, but the China and Russia can certainly play constructive roles in my view.
Well, there is one more question about which is, are there clear policy suggestions that Russia and China could implement to promote cooperation in areas of friction, and how far will they go to promote policies that seem friendly? I think that it's they have developed a very kind of complex mechanism of formal and informal exchange, including policy coordination. And yes, they have some frictions and they have some issues. And the diplomats complain sometimes to me that they have to wake up in the night and receive calls or angry calls from China and vice versa. So we have lots of situations like this between Russia and China. But I think that the ways to avoid this is to try to match and reconcile their sometimes colliding, conflicting interests, first, and secondly, is to broaden their agenda. So they just try to broaden and create new spheres of collaboration, even given the fact that they have some sort of, they have to divide and they labor. Like, for example, Syria, there is a big now concern in Russia that China will probably reap the fruits of the military campaign in Syria and will start getting into the economic sphere of Syria reconstruction and getting access to the Syrian oil reserves eventually as the compensation for their efforts. So I guess there is a concrete dialogue between the Russian side and the Chinese side about what, who doing what in Syria. And what when we see the Egypt situation or Libya situation, the Chinese are trying to maintain and announce that they have, they are trying to maintain their kind of neutrality in the these situations and conflicts. Sometimes using and appealing to Russia's military contribution to settle and support some sides. But we never know actually whether it was done, it is done in collaboration, in coordination with China or not. So I think that broaden the agenda items, multilateralization of their dialogue, especially in Central Asia, they invite the more countries, and we remember India, Pakistan became the partners within the SCO. So that is the way to really avoid direct frictions and confrontation among each other.
I might just comment quickly that on Syria, it is interesting. I don't see a lot of evidence of Chinese involvement there, but they are watching extremely closely what Russia is doing. On a military side, they are trying to learn, so you see articles, what kind of Russian weaponry is useful, what Russian tactics, and maybe they've taken it even a step further to say that they think that this is some kind of, even going as far as calling it kind of a model of a kind of counter-terrorist operation done with kind of minimalish resources. Although, I remember being in St. Petersburg and having a Russian specialist say, well, you realize this whole Syrian war is bankrolled by the Chinese, right? And I remember thinking, well, it's hard to think about it that way. But if you think back to 2015, 2016, it doesn't sound so crazy. So, in a sense, China's role, even if it's unspoken, it is going to play a role, a big role, larger and larger in the Middle East. And it will, we'll have to see whether Russia and China can, play a kind of positive coordinating role. I think it's yet to be seen, but I think we can project that it will grow.
Yes, another interesting question is Russia plus China more powerful than the US? That's a good question for Lyle, but let me just say one word on this. What kind of power we are talking about? In terms of now, we live in a world of a new perception of power. As we could refer as structural power. So power in terms of, as I said, agenda setting or rule making in the world. And it seems to be the fact that the U.S., Russia, and China have been in the EU as well, have been into the competition on who will actually hold structural power in the near to probably decades. And in this respect, we see the United States still remains powerful. It has changed a little bit its strategic emphasis, but it is part of the important international rulemaking process, right? Is Russia and China trying to develop, but especially develop some sort of new developmental model and governance model, especially China, and try to alternate, as I said earlier, the American Western type of a model, governance model, developmental model, political system, and compete in this respect with the United States. So which one is powerful? In terms of military side, probably I'll ask Lyle to elaborate on this.
Sure. Well, debating, we have a lot of experts who debate the quality and character of military balances, and it surely is complex. Generally, I am in the school of Fareed Zakaria's thinking that it's not that the United States is weakened, it's more that we're seeing the rise of the rest. And indeed, China, after decades of being focused inward and suffering a lot of problems, has now set on a course of really strongly improving its military capabilities. And I think we're seeing a lot of the results of these. Generally, though, in a lot of the scenarios that come up, whether we're talking about the Ukraine or the Caucasus or Central Asia or in the Taiwan Strait and so forth, these are areas that are very proximate, right, to both China and also Russia. And geography, is a huge, maybe even the dominant factor in military affairs, maybe along with national will. So when you put those two things together, it's true that China and Russia, all of themselves, by the way, and often one critique of why suggesting they may not come together in a formal alliance is they don't really need to. That is, China does not need the Russian Navy to come to its rescue in the South China Sea, and the Russian Navy does not need, the Chinese Navy to appear in the Baltic or the Black Sea. But it is in the scenarios that are most often discussed, it is true that Russian and Chinese power are formidable, and I think too often underestimated, I would say, in the West for various reasons.
Okay, maybe another question, one or two more questions. Another question is that, is there any competition between Russia and China on the Balkans, larger European considerations? I guess we have, I mentioned the Greater Eurasian Partnership, and it is a very interesting situation that China has been very adamant in terms of reaching out to Europe, especially through its Belt and Road Initiative and Silk Road Economic Belt. And since 2013, it has been very much persistent in fighting, especially against the United States, especially during Obama's mega regionalism over influence on Europe, in Europe. Whereas Russia has been drifting from being more like Eurocentric in terms of its foreign policy toward a little bit more Eurasianist type of foreign policy and status and identity. And now what is now the Greater Eurasian Partnership is an attempt to probably return Europe into the embrace of both Russia and China as the very important element of the new partnership, probably vis-a-vis the United States. So now this competition, tacit competition between China and the United States over Europe remains. Russia has less leverage in terms of its influence in Europe, especially given the recent development of unwillingness of Russia even to discuss issues with Europe while we're speaking about European leaders as kind of irrelevant or they're living in a kind of strange reality. But the overall, I think that the joint efforts might be efficient in terms of reaching out and developing certain strategies toward Europe.
Right, and maybe I'll just close with this answer to this final question from Victor Shmagin, who asks if the new phase of the Sino-Russian relationship is based on real shared interests and cooperation, has the problem of the unequal treaties from the mid 19th century finally been resolved? And I guess, I'm not a historian, you're the historian, Victor, but I think it has, I think to some extent been resolved. I think, from what I can see on both sides, they're aware of the history, but they don't want the history to dominate them. Partly they know how bad things got in the 60s through in the 70s and in the 80s. China and Russia were on the brink of war, and that has powerfully shaped their perceptions. And I think in some degree, Westerners looking at this have often thought, having seen the Sino-Soviet conflict, that's the norm in the relationship. But I would encourage people to think about it maybe another way. If you look across the sweep of hundreds of years, actually, Russia and China have the border area and their relations have been relatively peaceful. So that Sino-Soviet conflict looks more and more like an anomaly, often actually caused by very strange personality conflicts and egos and things like that. Now, those exist today too, but I think, you know, there's a very powerful trend in both countries to keep those kind of inclinations in check and to pursue their joint and common interests. So I think by my count, we'll have to close it there, but I would just wrap up the session by thanking everybody so much. Please stay in touch with us. Please send us your comments and further questions. We'll be working on this for the next couple of years together and look forward to dialoguing more with you and other specialists. A big shout out, thank you to Harvard Davis Center and Fairbank for